Hi, everybody. Today we're going to be talking about sewer pirates, or gully piraten, der Schrecken der Kanalisation, in German. And this is a pretty simple, straightforward set collection game set in the sewers under some big city where a bunch of anthropomorphized little critters, like slugs and weasels and whatnot, have taken on pirate trappings to sail the seven sewers and collect all kinds of fabulous pirate booty out there. Like I said, it's basically a set collection game mixed with card management and a healthy dose of hopscotch. So let's get right into it. The first thing that happens is when you set up the board, there's three pirate ships. The cat one, the fish one, and the bird one. Up ahead in the sewers, there's some randomly selected booty, and then some stuff further on that you'll be able to get to a little bit later. There's a Ticket to Ride style layout of cards that you can draw cards from, and each player starts with their own hand of cards. Now, there's a few different ways the game can start depending on how complicated you want to make it. You can go for a really simple, family-friendly version where, you know, one player picks just one type of creature, like the slug. I'll be the slugs. And Jen, she'll be the cockroaches. Because of course Jen loves cockroaches. I certainly don't, after having been in Malta for a few months now. There's probably a cockroach under this couch even as we speak. A live one. But best not think about that. Anyway, you pick a species, and it doesn't matter because it's just for identification. None of the special abilities of the species are used, and you just play a very straightforward version of the game. It's very, very simple, easily playable by families. You could bump it up a notch and take these six race cards and draw four at random. In this case, I drew a toad and a weasel and a cockroach and a slug. And these are the four types of creatures that everybody has, which means everybody has the exact same chances, nothing's unbalanced, and those creatures all have special abilities. The most complex way to play starts actually with an auction to find out your crew. And so what you do is you take one of these ships, flip it over, and there's a sewer bar that you can go to hire your pirate crew. And in fact, if you need more, each of these has a back, so if you're playing with more players, you can have a longer bar. But in a two-player game, we just need eight spots because each player has four crew members. And so what we do is we draw these cards randomly, and I will just kind of grab them randomly from a pile, one-handed. There is a pirate. So he's first up. What else we got? We got a weasel, a toad, and a slug. So weasel, a toad, and a slug. Weasel, toad, say it with me, everybody, and a slug. Okay, and then the next player takes the six cards, shuffles them up again. Yay, one-handed shuffling. Okay, and draws again, see what else we get. So next, another rat. And a, what's this? Another toad, two toads. Okay. And, I don't know, another slug. And finally, the last one, a cockroach. Okay. And now what that means is, weasel and raccoon. We did not get any raccoons, so I'm going to cheat a little bit, and I'm going to remove one of these doubled up creatures so that we can get a, I'll dump this, the second toad we had, instead pretend I had drawn a raccoon, because I really want to be able to show how all six creature types work. Okay, so this is the lineup of scallywags and ne'er-do-wells who you would like to hire. And for this particular way you play the game, every player starts with eight cards drawn randomly. And these are what we're using to bid. Now, what you don't bid with becomes your starting hand. So I really want to look at what I got here. Da, 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 So I've got a lot of fish cards, a few kitty cards, and one bird card. And Jen, she's got eight as well, but you know, I'm just going to bid blind with hers. All right, so we start bidding. We go from left to right. Whoever's in the first spot, you could open a bid with zero, one, two. If I wanted to go right to this cockroach, which is the only cockroach in the game and I want him really bad, I'd have to do an opening bid of seven, which I'm not going to do because that's a bit expensive when I only have eight to bid with. So let's just start. Let's see. Actually, you know what? There's only one weasel. And I would like to have the weasel because wheels are awesome. So I'm actually going to skip. I could start bidding on this for nothing, but I'm going to skip him, which means I have to bid at least one for this weasel. And I really want that weasel, so I'm in fact going to bid two for the weasel. I'm going to bid one, this, and this. And you actually bid them face down, of course, so as not to give up. So I'm bidding two. The one, and then one more. And now Jen has to raise me by three if she wants that weasel. And I don't think she does. She doesn't want to pay three for him. She doesn't want him that much. So I got him. I paid two. These are out. And I got a weasel. And now I take him. And you'll notice there's these wonderful little colored stands, which honestly, I don't understand why all mini games don't do this. It's such a clever solution for such a really common problem. So you just slide into place. Boom. And I've got a green weasel. Okay, now, in kind of a, small world style, since this guy got passed over, a card now goes on him to make him more attractive. And now it's Jen's turn to do an opening bid. And so, I guarantee, let's see, she could open a bid of zero, and then of course I'm going to bid at least one because it'll be free for me. So she probably wants to start opening bid of one, because she would like the rat. The rat would be nice. So she will open with a bid of one. And now do I want to raise? I've already just paid two. I only have eight. And again, whatever you don't pay is what your starting hand is. So you want to start out with at least three or four or five cards. So I'm just going to, let that go. So basically, she got that guy for free. She paid with that, but then she got this for free. And so she got a rat. There you go. Captain, sir. All right, next up, my turn to bid. I've got a frog who is zero, or I could skip him and go to a slug. And you know what? I think I do want to skip in. I want to get that I'd like to get the other. I don't want Jen to get both pirates. I don't really want the slug particularly. But okay, I will bid one for the slug. Yeah. And so I bid one fish. And Jen says, "You can have them. I don't like slugs. The slugs are fine. This is the one guy I have who actually has a bent sword. I should say the quality of these is really spectacular. Of all the characters I got, I only had one bent thing. So I just want to bring out a nice little slug. Look at that little fella with a lovely sword. So anyway, so I've got a slug. It cost me one. And now Jen's bid again. So she's got the toe. Oh, and again, of course." There's a freebie on there. So Jen will bid. She doesn't want the toad. I don't want the toad. But she'll bid nothing. And now I'm like, well, if I let her have the toad, she'll get a free card. But yeah, I will. So she just got an extra card for trouble. And she got a toad. There's nothing wrong with the toad. The toad's as good as anybody else, but he's definitely the trickiest guy to use. His special ability requires a bit more long-term planning. So so that was Jen. Now it's my turn again. I'm definitely going to open bidding at zero for the rat. Oh, but she'll probably bid me up because she's got a bunch of cards now. So I will start bidding at one for the rat. And now does Jen want to go up to two? I think she will. So she's got two rats, which actually sucks for me. So, because actually, am I going to go up to three? Let's see. I bid one, and so she's outbidding me. She bid two. I could go up to three, but nope. I just make her pay two to get the rat. So she's got two rats. That's not good. Now it's her turn. She can bid first for this raccoon. And now, there's only one cockroach. She wants that cockroach. She's going to jump the gun a bit and go zero, one, two. She is going to bid two for this cockroach. And now I could raise her. I could bid three. I've got three, and I could get the cockroach. But that's just too rich for my blood. I really want to hold on to cards for starting. So she got the cockroach for two. And her party is now complete. This is her crew. Two pirates, a toad, and a cockroach. Pretty nice. And she is going to start with one, two, three, four, five cards in her hand. which we'll just put over here since it's secret information. And now that raccoon got passed, and well, you know, Jen's out of bidding. She can't bid anymore, so I get these last two guys for free. So I got an extra card, a bird, very nice, and I got a raccoon. So I've got two slugs, a raccoon and a weasel. Jen's got two rats, a cockroach, and a toad. That is actually a very interesting matchup, and I have one more card than her at the beginning. So we are done with the auction. Now, like I said, that is not necessary. It's just kind of a fun way to start to make each team a little bit personalized, and it's implicitly balanced because the players, through their bidding, chose what they were going to get. And there's a little bit of thought, but it's not too terribly deep. There's also, I should say, there's an official variant from the designer on BoardGameGeek. It's kind of an interim where it's just two teams of four, and you get the whole team, and you just do a bid on the team as a whole as opposed to the individuals. But this is obviously the most deep and interesting way to go. So anyway, we're all done. We are ready to start. That's the discard pile. And here we go. Now, I was the last person to draw anything, which means I'm the first person to get to go. So, on a turn, I have four choices of what I can do. I can draw more cards, two specifically, Ticket to Ride style. I can use the cards I've got to either move forward on the ship or, if I'm far enough along, to become captain, but there's special rules for captains, so that's why it's a different action. I can either move up on the ship, or I can become captain, and the fourth action I can do is set sail, which only happens when I am a captain. So, I am going to play some cards, I think. Yeah, baby. I am going to... Yeah, what the heck. I'm going to play all three kitty cat cards, because I happen to have three. One, two, three. So those get discarded. Now what that means is I am going to move one of my crew forward onto the cat boat. So to do that, I could do a slug, a weasel, or a raccoon. I'm going to have a slug move up. And so what it does is you have to pretend I'm on the dock. I haven't gotten on the ship yet. I've played three cards, so I move forward. One, two, three. And I am one step away from the captain's chair. Right, so that was my turn. Now it's Jen's turn. Let's see, and I got to look at what card she has because I have no idea. She's got that. Okay. So what does she want to do? She is going to... She's going to play... Oh, wow. Look at that. That worked out pretty nicely for her. She is going to play three kitty cat cards, which she just happens to have. She is going to get onto my boat. So, and who's she going to take? She's going to take one of her pirates. Here we go. And now... Wait a minute. Is she going to do that? No, she can't. What I thought I was going to do was actually have her just jump right to the front of the ship. But to become a captain, when you move forward, this is the rule, and this is a really important rule. It's kind of easy for guys. Yeah, I just forgot it. When you want to become a captain, you can only make the move into the captain's chair if there are no empty spaces in front of you. If you imagine this pirate is back here on the dock, there's empty spaces in front of him. So until this space... So if I happen to have this and this, there's no empty spaces in front of this pirate, he could jump right to the captain's chair. But because there's empty spaces, he has to go into them. So instead, Jen is just going to play one, two kitty cat cards and make it to one space behind the slug. Now, I forgot on my turn, the special ability of the slug, if you look over here, is that after he moves, he gets to draw a card and see if he is lucky and gets to randomly move again. So what we do is we draw a card, and if this card is going to be a kitty cat card, he actually got to move one more space. And it was a kitty cat card. Ugh. Okay, so that maybe changes what Jen was going to do. Let's say Jen hasn't played her kitty cat card yet. Sorry about that. She took him back. So, at the end, he moved, I paid three to move up here, and then I drew a kitty cart, and because there's no empty space in front of him, he was able to move into the captain's chair. Now, it's Jen's turn. Sorry, I've rewound now. It's Jen's turn. She sees that this ship has a captain, which means on the next turn, on my turn, this ship is going to set sail. Jen does not want to let that ship set sail without her, so she is going to jump on board. She's only going to pay one kitty cat card instead of two. And so, boom, she kind of caught on the tail end, and she made it before it set sail. She, as you know, because I accidentally revealed it, she had up to three kitty cat cards, but there was no reason for her to move any further up the ship, because once you set sail, the dispersal of the booty is a very straightforward thing, which I'm going to demonstrate right now. She only played one cat, she's on the tail end of the ship, and now it's my turn. I have a captain, which means I have no choice. I can't draw cards, I can't play cards. I have to set sail now. This ship is setting sail with my slug and her rat. So off we go. You'll see there are up ahead in the sewer waters, a can of ravioli, a burger, a box of ramen noodles, something like that, and then sweet chilies. Now, the captain, captain's prerogative, he always gets the special bonus round token. So, automatically, my slug got the sweet chilies. And now, we now have three things. Everybody who's on the ship gets one of them in descending order. So, the slug is first, so he gets one of these things, and I think I'm going to take the ramen. So that's the beginning of my set collection. I got some ramen and I got some sweet chilies. And my slug is done. Off he jumps. Now, Jen's at the tail end, and she's got a rat. Now, the rat's special ability is, whenever he's drawing booty, he gets two instead of one. My slug, he got the free bonus for being captain, but he only got to have one thing. Jen's rat gets two, so she gets the other two things, a ravioli and a burger. And again, that goes face down, and her rat comes home. So, Jen kind of rode on my coattails. I paid big money to, three cards to make it all the way up there, and generally paid one, and she, because it was a pirate, she got double, but I got stuff as well. Anyway, so we both jumped ship. Now, the ship has moved on further into the sewers, so these are now within reach. These are going to be the next thing it sails for, and then we draw some new stuff to see what's even further on in the sewers. Some more noodles, some french fries, delicious, a teddy bear, and a parrot. Okay. But now in the short term, there's a teddy bear, some fries, a shake, a delicious vanilla shake, or strawberry or chocolate, who knows, and another burger. So anyway, that was my turn, was setting sail. Now it's back to Jen's turn. She can draw cards, she can play cards to move up. And she's got all four of her guys available. What is she going to do? She is going to, I need to remember, what is she going to do? She is going to draw some cards. She's going to draw a blue fish card. And now she can draw another one or a blind. She will draw a blind, so no one knows what it is. And now, these get refilled. My turn. Okay, I've only got three cards. I probably want to draw some cards too, instead of making a move on a boat. I'm going to draw, let's see. Now, I got no kitty cat cards. And you got to start thinking in terms of what stuff do I want to make sure I get, because this is all about set collection and also set combination stuff as well. I've already now started kind of down the road of getting these ramen, so I'd really like to get more. And you can see off the fish and bird ships, there's ramen in both of those. So I probably want to start moving up to get some more ramen, since there's no ramen here in the short term. So I've got one bird card and two fish cards. I think I will put myself in a better position to move up on both these ships. I'm going to draw a bird card, and do I want another bird card, or do I want a... I think I'll draw blind and see what I get. And I got another bird card anyway. Okay, so I drew two cards. Now it's Jen's turn. She could draw more cards. However, she's got six cards right now, and if you ever draw cards, after the draw action, you have to discard down to six, so it would make no sense for her to draw a card. She's going to play some cards now. What is she going to play? Let's see. She got the ravioli and the burger. Well, let's keep it not secret. I mean, you're not supposed to remember, but just for my own purposes, just for my own benefit, so like when I think about her, I'll remember that. But this guy is going to, over time, going to remember less and less of what she got. So she is going to... she's going to make a move with her cockroach. Now, the cockroach's special ability, if we look over here on the board, is it costs him one less card to move forward than anybody else. So he can effectively move one for free. But let's see. So Jen is going to play two fish cards. One, two. Discard. And that means this cockroach can move three spaces. One, two, three. So she's just made a big power move on the fish ship. And her turn's over. My turn now. And I'm like, well, what do I want to do? Now, I'm worried that, that ship might be taken off without me. And that could be a problem. And in fact, I do not have enough fish cards. And, because there's blank spaces, there's no way I can make captain of that ship now, because Jen's moved up so far. Well, actually, wait, no, that's not true. There is one way I could potentially do it. It's a bit of a gamble, but let's give it a go. I am going to gamble. In fact, it's only a 33% chance of success, but it will actually give you an opportunity to see the slug's ability in action again. I'm going to pay two fish. I'm going to take my slug again and move up one, two. Remember, I get to draw a card. And if it's a fish, let it be a fish, let it be a fish, this little slug will get to move one step further ahead and push the cockroach out of the way. So 33% chance, 33.33333% chance, is it a fish? It's a kitty cat. All right. Well, nothing ventured, nothing gained. Fortune favors the bold, except in this case. So anyway, so I paid two, which is kind of a pain. I should have just, if I could have paid one, I would have been on the boat anyway, but all right. So now it's Jen's turn. So now she's got a situation where she could, I mean, remember, the cockroach gives move one space for free. There's nothing blocking her from the captain's chair. She can move one and, you know, and cause this ship to set sail. But it'll be one more turn before it sets sail, which gives me a chance to get another crew member on board and pick out more stuff than she would get. So does she want to set sail right away, or does she want to ensure she's the one who, gets more of this booty? And, you know, I think, in fact, is she going to take a risk? Yeah, I think so. I think she's going to take a risk. Ooh. Yeah. Because here's the thing. She doesn't know if I've got any more, fish cards. Because if I do, if she, say, she moves this, this toad here, so that she can get more booty when this thing sets sail, what her risk is that I have another fish card. Because if I do, then I come back here and, you know, potentially if I got enough fish cards, I can jump all the way to the captain's chair and skip the whole thing. So that's the risk she's taken by jumping onto the ship again. But I think it is a risk she's willing to take. So she plays another fish card because she happened to have. And she is going to get another pirate on the board, which means she'll get to pick up two instead of one. My turn. Did her risk pay off? Yes, it did, because there's no way I can get on the boat. So there's nothing I can do about that, which is too bad. While she's off doing that, I guess I might as well get myself into position to start working on one of the other boats. I will spend two, count them. I'll spend two birds, one, two, and move this raccoon one, two spaces onto the bird boat. All right, Jen's turn, and now I'm almost out of cards. So, what is she going to do? Now, her cockroach, remember, can move for free because it's one less cost. So she can, get on the boat right now. Let's see. Yeah, she might as well. She's moving the cockroach for free. All right, that was her move. She didn't play any cards to do that because cockroach's ability. My turn again. Now, if I, on the previous turn, had actually drawn a couple of cards blind, I might have had I had a 33% chance of getting another, fish card. And if I had done that, then I would be able to get into this space. See, I mean, would there have been one? Nah, it doesn't matter. There wouldn't have been anyone anyway. Let's just reshuffle that a little bit. So, but if I had, last turn I'd drawn some more blues, I could now hopscotch and get into this space and be closer to the front of the boat. However, Jen's gamble's paid off. I don't have the stuff I need to do that. So instead, I'm just going to draw a fish card and a fish card, and to make a bigger move on the fish boat. Okay. Let's see. Yeah. You know what? Yeah. All right. So that's fine. Okay. So now it's Jen's turn. She's got a captain, so this ship is setting sail, which means she automatically gets this can opener, which is nice for her because it means she'll be able to open up these raviolis later. You'll notice the matching colors. Can opener opens up raviolis, which means if she hadn't gotten a can opener at the end of the game, this raviolis would be worth nothing. But now, these two together are worth 16 points. Very nice for her. And now she gets to take one of these things, and I think she will take the fries. And then the cockroach jumps ship. Now my slug, he gets next up. I get some more ramen, so I'm starting to build up my ramen collection. Now off jumps my slug. And now her rat, whose special ability lets him have two things, unfortunately there's only one thing left. So her rat gets little orphan Andy doll. And that ship, the ship has sailed. We move on further down, reveal some new stuff. Another ramen off in the distance, another doll, another burger, and randomly another can opener. All right, so that was her turn. We set sail. My turn now. Let's see. Now, since I don't have these nice pirates that let you draw two, I gotta work hard to be able to get the lion's share booty. And so I really want to, if I can, gobble up all this stuff, because you notice there's a can opener and a can right next to each other. If I can get both of those, that's great. I definitely want to get this ravioli, or the ramen too, so I can keep on with the set building. So I want to make sure I'm in a situation where I can get all three of those, which means I got to have a captain to get that. I've got to, and to get that and say that, to get these both together. Then I got to have somebody else up front to ensure I get that and don't get stuck with the burger, which is less interesting to me. So I've already got my raccoon in place. And I am going to, do I want to get another guy on board or do I want to move the raccoon up? I think I'm going to move the raccoon up. I'm going to pay one. Move him up. No, I'm not. I'm not going to do that. I'm going to pay one. And, oh yes, that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to pay two, in fact. Pay two. And bring out my weasel. My weasel gets to move two spaces. And now here's where the hopscotch action actually works. So the weasel, I paid two, so I paid one. And now, because I can't move here, I get to skip over for free, and that was my space two. So I'm now in second place on the boat. Now, the weasel's special ability is that he gets to do two moves in a row if you've got the cards to do it. And it just so happens I do. I've got one more bird card. So now he gets to move again. And so for his second move, I will play my last bird card. And because there's nobody between the weasel and the captain's chair, I will move up. And boom, I am ready to set sail. I'm also completely out of chits. But now, let's see. So Jen's got a last minute chance to get onto this boat. Let's see what she's got. Now, of course, she can get onto the... Well, that's actually interesting. Yeah. All right. So, her cockroach, of course, gets to move one for free. So, he could just move, and she's definitely on the boat. Now, it just so happens, she's got a single bird card. So, now what you'd think is, what would be great for her is, like me, she could hopscotch. You know, she'd pay one for free, and then she'd pay that one bird card to hopscotch, and now she's ahead of my raccoon, and so she gets second dibs on stuff, which would be nice for her. However, the special ability of the raccoon is, he's basically a wall. To hop over him, normally, it's free. It just costs the card that would take to move. You could basically get to skip this space and move. So normally it just costs one to go over a character. However, the raccoon, his ability is, as a wall, he costs an extra. So it actually costs two. And unfortunately, Jen does not actually have two spaces. So she cannot make it into that space. So I think, with that in mind, before the ship sets sail, she's just going to jump on board before it's gone, and she's going to save that for other bird card for another. But again, if this had been a slug blocking the way, Jen could pay, and she would be able to get ahead of the slug and do the hopscotch stuff. So anyway, so she made it on, didn't cost her any cards, and now it's my turn, and I've got a weasel as captain, so this ship sets sail. So off we go. And captain gets a can opener, and I will use that can opener at the end of the game to open up this 12-point can of raviolis, and I will take yet another ramen. Nice. Actually, that was kind of dumb for Jen. Oh, well, I'll explain why that was dumb, and then I'll undo her dumb mistake. It's so hot here. I'm not thinking very clearly. But anyway, so the captain. Oh no, of course it's not. Sorry, I got the weasel and the rat mixed up. So the captain took the can opener. The captain took the can and jumped off. Then the raccoon jumped off. He's the one who took the ramen, which leaves, for Jen, the cockroach, this burger, which goes down into her collection of stuff, and the cockroach jumps off. Right, and so now some more stuff moves down. And there's some ketchup, and a teddy bear, and some fries, and another teddy bear. Double teddy bears up there. All right, so that was my move. Now it's Jen's move. Let's see. What would she like to do? What have I not shown you? I've shown you how the cockroach works, the rat works, the raccoon, the weasel, the slug. I think the only one I haven't shown you is the toad. So what the toad is for, the toad is interesting in that he's kind of a long-term planning thing. If you can see stuff further on down the sewer that you want to up your chances of getting because it's really important for you for set collection, like say Jen really wants to get this parrot. It's the first parrot we've seen come out. So Jen does not want to miss out on that parrot. You use the toad to up your chances down the road of doing that. So let's actually make that so. Jen is going to take, pay 1-2 kitty cat cards to move this toad 1-2 onto that boat. And now it's my turn. Right. And I got no cards. I think it's time for me to draw some cards. What do you think, folks? Let's draw some cards. And I see, hey, Jen's moving on the kitty cat, so I definitely want to grab a kitty cat. So I'll draw that. And I think I'll draw another one. And now Jen is going to, she's going to draw some cards. She draws blind. And she draws blind again. Okay. And now it's my turn. I got the two kitty cat cards. I think I'm going to spend them. Let's see if this works out for me. I am going to spend the both kitty cat cards. I'm going to try to move the slug up again. So it's 1 and 2 to hopscotch and jump into first place on this boat. And now remember, the slug has his free chance to move up again. So 33% chance, draw a kitty card, draw a kitty card, draw a kitty card. It's a bird. Ah, all right. Slugs are cool when they move forward, and then they're kind of crappy when they don't. But anyway, so, but still, I'm ahead on this ship. And now it's Jen's turn again. Let's see. Now, she has the opportunity, if she has any kitty cat cards, she just has to play 1 to jump ahead and take the captain space. But that's if she has any cards. We don't know what she's got. And so, let's see. What I know what she's got, of course, and what she's going to do. She is actually going to play 1 birdie card and use that and the free motion of the cockroach to move forward 1-2. So she's onto the middle of this now. And I'm like, oh, what's going on? But actually, I've used up all my cards. I need some more cards because I can't do anything since I don't have a cockroach that can move for free. So now I'm thinking, oh, crap, I got to jump in on the... So I'm going to grab a bird card. And let's just draw 1 blindly, see what I get. All right. And this comes out. And now it's Jen's turn again. She's going to draw 2 cards, which you don't know what they are, but you do know that there are 4 cards. And now it's my turn again. And I am going to draw 2 more cards. And I would really like to get a kitty cat card. But the card gods are not being very friendly to me. Okay. And now it's Jen's turn. Let's see. What's she going to do? Yeah, I think that's what she's going to do. She is going to play 1 kitty cat card and get her pirate onto the... onto the tail end of this boat. So now the boat's almost full. Let's see. And I still don't have a kitty cat card, so I still can't make the jump into the captain's because this stupid slug just can't make it the rest of the way. So, and now that, Jen's like totally up on the boat. So anyway, it's my turn. If I had a kitty cat card, I'd play it, but I don't. So I kind of have to give up on that. I mean, even if I drew a kitty card now, well, I still know what Jen's got, so I'm going to draw. Do I get it? No. Come on, give me kitty cat. This is like trying to draw for purples and Ticket to Ride. Come on, give it to me. No. And now I'm at 6. If I have any more than 6 cards when I draw cards, I have to discard, so I've kind of got a full hand. So now it's Jen's turns. And well, you know what she thinks she's going to do? A kitty cat card, which is going to let her rat skip everybody, go directly into the captain's chair. And I'm like, curses! All right, so now it is my turn again. I have no kitty cat card. Doesn't matter. That ship's going to sail. All the booty's going to be taken because she put a pirate into the front, so she's going to get a bunch of stuff. So now I might as well start thinking about what else I'm going to do. See, I've got a couple birds. Jen started making a move on the bird. I think I'm going to pay 2 bird cards and to use my weasel. I'm going to have him move twice. Paid 1 to have him move 1, and then I paid again to have him move a second time and jump over. Screw that. Let's mix it up again. I'm gonna use a weasel and use 2 spaces, but I am going to pay 3 of the 4 fish cards I've got and have this weasel go 1, 2, 3. And then for his second move, my 4th card, boom, setting sail. And in fact, that worked out very nicely for me. So that was my turn. It's Jen's turn now. She wants to get on the ship before it's going to set sail. She can't because she has to set sail. So that was kind of like 1-2. I saw an opportunity. I'm going to get to set sail completely by myself. I have total access to this, and Jen gets none of it. But in the meantime, Jen's going to get to set sail here. So she's got the captain, so she gets the shake. And now the captain gets to take two things. And based on what she's taken before, I think she is going to take the burger and the fries. And that's what the captain took. And now, Sluggy, I get one thing, so I get a teddy bear. Not the greatest thing in the world, but I'm not going to say no to a teddy bear. And now, Toad is left all by his lonesome. He gets nothing. It's a very, very sad state of affairs for those who get left behind. However, in the case where somebody doesn't get anything, in a situation like this, he does not jump off the ship. Instead, he moves forward one space and gets to stick around for the next group. So, being the last man out doesn't really hurt because it just sets you up to be further along the ship for the next go-round of sewer junk. So I didn't actually get to show what the Toad's ability was. The interesting thing about him, you saw how he missed out, but now he's all the way at the front of the ship. He's in a great position for the next, to be able to get this parrot. In fact, it's very likely he will take the captain's chair on his turn. But that would have happened if it had been a slug or a weasel or a cockroach. They all would have stayed behind and moved forward. His thing is, if he has the option to take something, he doesn't have to. He can pass, not take anything, and stay on the ship. So that's his ability. And that's why, because Jen wanted to get this parrot, she got on here so that even if the Toad did get something, he would have stayed on so that he really got what he really wanted. But as it happened, he was going to stay anyway because I had jumped forward with whatever the heck it was I did. Did I get ours mixed up? I think I did. I sure did. I jumped forward with her raft. That's not what I jumped forward with. That exactly did happen. I grabbed her raft. Let's see. This is what we'd been. I had a slug, not her raft. I had moved the slug all the way up. We had set sail. And so what that means is the slug got the can opener and one thing, which was the can. And then the other slug got the teddy bear, let's say. And then the Toad, who... I've got it mixed up. Sorry. So hot. It was that Jen's pirate had moved up, right? Yeah, that's what it was. So that's why. Forget everything I just said for the last 45 seconds. Sorry, everybody. If I could edit it out, I would. But anyway, so she is now set up to get that parrot later on. But now it's my turn. And remember, I get to sail now because Jen did not have a chance to put anybody on this boat. So this weasel gets everything all to himself. So he'll take the can opener. And with can opener, you got to take ravioli. Although, of course, I want these noodles too. That's a tough choice. I'll take the ravioli though. And so the noodles and the burger are just literally out of the game. Some more stuff slides down. The boat comes free. New stuff comes out, etc. Now, I think that gives you kind of a rough idea of the order of events, of how things go. How, it's all about having the right cards at the right time, setting up for chain reactions of, anticipating what ship is going to sail, trying to get to the front of it, not setting yourself up to where you give the opponent an advantage, who can just jump past everything and take the captain's seat, using all the special abilities, etc., etc. So that's the basics of how this goes back and forth. The game goes until one ship has nothing in front of it. So basically, we've emptied all this stuff out. And then that's when final scoring happens. So now, I really need to talk about final scoring because it's really awesome cool. In fact, it's kind of what makes the game. So this is so much more than just a simple sets collection. So let's look at the end of the game and see what Jen had actually gotten for herself. So she got some fries. She got a can. She got, so far, she had three burgers. Shake. And she had a ravioli, and she had a can opener, and she had a, what's it? And now let's see, of course, she would have gotten more if the game had kicked going, so let's say she got some more stuff as well. She got that parrot she was after, and let's say she got a teddy bear, and let's say she got some more fries, and she got some ketchup, and she was really lucky and got two ketchups, and what else? She got another teddy bear. And she got another can of ravioli, right? Is that everything? I think that's all the type of stuff there is. There's the... and she got... let's see what else she got. Did she find one? Yeah, and she got a sweet chili. Okay, so this is what Jen ended up with. This was her haul, her take. And we start adding it up by actually doing the combinations. I already mentioned one of them that's pretty straightforward, how the cans can open can openers. She has one can opener and unfortunately two cans. So she will use the can opener to open this can to score 14 points. This can, unfortunately, with 11 points inside of it, is lost. She can't because she needs a can opener for every can. I guess they're old crappy can openers that break after only one use. I mean, look how this is a really old-fashioned can opener. So this, unfortunately, was lost. Didn't score any points off it, but scored 16 off of these two things. Now, she's got some fries. What goes well with fries? Ketchup, of course. And she got both ketchups in the game, which was absolutely awesome for her because these, combined with these, there's enough ketchup in each of these to spread over all the fries. So basically, what happens is these fries were worth 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 points. Not that big a deal. However, this ketchup is worth +5 for every one of the fries. So this is basically worth 15 points. And then this is another 15 points. This is 38 points for ketchup and fries because she was able to get both of those. And but throughout playing the game, if I had been paying attention and noticed she had gotten a lot of fries, I definitely don't want to let her get both of these ketchups. You really got to watch out what your opponent is doing. But you know, over time, they collect so much stuff, it's easy to lose track. So there can be this really big surprise reveal of, I got some fries and I got a ketchup. And another ketchup, 38 points, boom. Moving on. Same thing is true for these burgers and this shake. The shake basically goes with all the burgers, so it's 6, 11, 15, plus 3 on each of them is 9, so 24 points for these burgers and the matching shake. So she did really well on all that stuff. Now, I already mentioned how the can opener and cans work. And then finally, let's see, she got these sweet chilies. Now these sweet chilies, they enhance all those ramens I was getting. So I really wanted to have that sweet chili. And you could imagine Jen actually ensured that she got it to make sure I didn't get it, so she didn't get one of those double combos. It's worth 4 points by itself. She didn't get any ramen to back it up, but still, 4 points is 4 points. And more to the point, this was like maybe 16 points she took away from me by ensuring that she got it. And now finally, we have our kidnap victims. Jen got two teddies and a little orphan Annie doll. Now, the way these combine is with the parrot, because you can't score any points. You can't score any ransom for these things unless you've got somebody who can talk to the humans and give your ransom demands. So that's the thematic tie between the parrot. But this parrot has to decide, is he going to do ransom for the teddies or the dollies? In this case, it's a no-brainer. This parrot went off and ransomed the teddies. The parrot was worth 1 by himself, but then the teddies, that's 15, so that's 16 total. If Jen had gotten another parrot, that one could have done the dolls. And if she'd gotten a parrot and, you know, 3 dolls, you know, this would have been kind of like an ideal thing. 2 parrots, 1 for all of her, Raggedy Ann dolls and 1 for her teddies, this would have been a very big haul too. So, and that's what she got, and it's worth a lot of points. Presumably, I got a whole bunch of stuff that's worth points too. But really, whether you win or lose depends on how smart you played on the boats and how smart not only did you go for set collection, but combo collection as well. And how well did you prevent your opponent from getting their target combo stuff. And that's what Sewer Pirates is all about. And now, if you were to turn around and see my sweaty, sweaty face, oh my goodness, I would then wrap up what I think about Sewer Pirates, which is awesome. This is a surprisingly good little game. Now, I have to admit, it came out last year. Didn't really make a big splash at Essen. Obviously, it has absolutely amazing menus. I mean, these are, comparable to the quality of what you'd find in War of the Ring. Or, really, really top-end game. I mean, just really. And the detail in these things, you can see the teeth on this rat. If I knew how to paint figures, I would. I mean, hell, this game actually prompts me to want to learn how to paint. They're so, so nice. And then as well, they're really tough. They were so well packaged, nice big, kind of bubble balloons, so that of all of them, they all have these little pointy swords that'd be so easy to bend. I only had one bent sword in the whole box, which was awesome. The other nice thing, I got this game for super cheap, because I was on Board Game Guru for, 16, 15 euros. A steal. That's why I picked it up. I didn't really expect to care that much about the game. I just knew they were good minis, and it was a really low-priced game. Was totally blown away, surprised how great it was. Now, okay, it's not the greatest thing since sliced bread. It's not going to replace a Grickle or anything like that. But great fun, fast little game. Jen and I enjoyed it very much, plays very well with two. Really, you know, it's all about bluffing, psyching out your opponent, trying to remember what they're doing, you know, saying to yourself, like, how I got that one weasel to sail all by himself. Whenever that happens, it feels fantastic, particularly if you have two guys on the ship. Or when, you know, somebody looks like they're about to sail, but then and you just jump right to the captain's chair. You get those really great, exciting moments, you know, a lot of tension of, oh, can I get on that ship? Just draw the card, just, I need that card. Oh, I didn't get the card. Or, yay, I got the card. So much fun little stuff. All the abilities of the creatures are interesting. They're all very nice. I mean, you can make an argument that the weasel is super powerful because he gets to move twice in one turn, but it's expensive to use him. You know, Jen was really lucky to have actually two pirates in her crew. I really shouldn't have let her do that because these guys pull twice as much treasure as anybody else, so she was doing really, really well to have that monopoly. Anyway... great little game. Very, very fun. Very simple. Very fluid. I could definitely see this playing great with families because they're, you know, the game's got such a great sense of whimsy. I don't know, maybe some kids would be grossed out by the fact that they can actually have a cockroach they're playing with. But, you know, even this cockroach, I mean, look at him. He's adorable. He's got his little sword over his head. And he's got his big sweet antenna and all that. And he's just ready for action. And these cockroaches are awesome, too, with their whole getting to move for free or at least one less than normal. Great game. Very much recommend it, you know, for family members or for family fun, or if you're looking for something, you know, a little bit, maybe kind of in the light medium range, can't go wrong with Sewer Rats or Die Gully Piraten. My name is Richard Hamm. Thanks for watching. Talk to you guys soon. Bye-bye.